Thank you. That concludes topical questions. And we will move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 8205 in the name of Ivan McKee on Trade Australia New Zealand Bill UK legislation. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Ivan McKee to speak to and move the motion. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, it is with no small amount of regret and frustration that we find ourselves here today considering this motion. Yet again, it appears that the UK Government is willing to play fast and loose with devolution and to play little heed to the democratic role of this Parliament in scrutinising law made in devolved areas. The Trade Australia and New Zealand Bill would provide UK Government ministers with a delegated power to legislate directly on devolved matters in Scotland, bypassing Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament entirely. The one thing we can be grateful for is that the Bill, despite its grandstanding title, has a relatively narrow focus. Our views on the trade deals which the UK Government has agreed with Australia and with New Zealand are well known, and the Scottish Government has no direct role in negotiating these deals, and we are very concerned by the impact of both agreements, particularly with regard to agri-foods. But that is not today's focus. This bill is solely about the implementation of the Government procurement chapters of those agreements. As a result of these agreements, amendments are needed to procurement legislation to extend duties of equal treatment to bidders from Australia and New Zealand and to make some minor amendments to procedural rules. Procurement is, of course, a devolved matter. The UK Government has opted in this bill to confer a power to make these amendments by secondary legislation. This power is drafted too broadly and of greater concern would be excisable concurrently by both UK and Scottish ministers, meaning that UK ministers would be able to exercise it in devolved areas without securing the consent of Scottish ministers. The bill also allows for the implementation of future amendments to the Australia and New Zealand agreements. This is a curious provision to include when the agreements have only just been reached and the power is expected to be repealed by the UK Government's procurement bill in the coming months. The Scottish Government's Legislative Consent Memorandum did not recommend consent to this, and the Economy and Fair Work Committee's subsequent report, whom I thank for their efforts, concluded that there should be a means for the Scottish Parliament to scrutinise regulations laid by the UK Government that fall within devolved competence. I and officials have engaged with counterparts in the UK Government over many months in an effort to address these concerns. I met with the UK Minister for International Trade in early December and have written to him twice since then and met with the relevant UK Government Minister earlier today. We have suggested three different ways in which the bill could be appropriately amended. The first option would be to make the provision necessary to implement these agreements on the face of the bill, allowing the Scottish Parliament to consider precisely what it might be consenting to. The second option would be to amend the power so that it is conferred solely on Scottish ministers in relation to devolved matters. And the third option would be to introduce a statutory requirement for UK ministers to secure the consent of Scottish ministers before exercising the power in relation to devolved matters. These are entirely reasonable and practical suggestions which the UK Government has unfortunately rejected out of hand. The UK Government's view, one that I do not accept, is that it must maintain a power by secondary legislation to implement international obligation in order to ensure that they are complied with. But such a view implies that of the two governments, it is the Scottish Government which is the one which has difficulty with the rule of international law. And I don't think that is a conclusion many observers would be drawing right now. Indeed, the Scottish Government has implemented their international obligations in relation to procurement successfully, separately from and sometimes differently to the rest of the UK for almost 20 years now, and at no point has there ever been any question mark raised over our compliance with international obligations. Give way.
Daniel Johnson.
I very much agree with the frustrations the Minister has set out. I was wondering if he could set out what attempts he has made to have dialogue with UK Government and UK Ministers, discuss these issues and find a way through.
Minister.
As I already indicated in my remarks so far, I've written twice to UK Government Ministers and I've met with the relevant UK Government Minister in the Commons previously on this, and just today I met with Lord Johnson, the relevant UK Government Minister, in the Lords to discuss these issues. And in addition to that, officials have had extensive interaction on all of these issues over a period of some time now. So the UK government did approach us with what it described as a compromise proposal, something we have discussed with them through those that dialogue. If we were willing to recommend consent to the bill, it would be willing to amend the bill so that the power would only become exercisable by UK ministers in relation to devolved matters if either the Scottish ministers asked the UK government to legislate on their behalf, which clearly would be acceptable to us, or if, following a request from UK ministers, the Scottish ministers had failed to legislate within 15 days. So while we may have been able to secure an improvement on the idea that Scottish ministers would only have had 15 days, a ludicrous proposal, of course, from the arbitrary date of any such request in which to consider, draft and make any legislation, the UK government was clear that it would not budge on the issue of consent. Of course, this is a significant matter of principle, and so I was unable to agree to their proposal. Presiding officer, it is not for the lack of effort on our part that we have ended up in this situation, but so long as the Trade Australia New Zealand Bill contains a provision to allow UK ministers to be able to legislate in a devolved area without first seeking the consent of Scottish ministers, I cannot recommend this Parliament gives its consent. I believe it's also worth noting that the Welsh Senate has withheld its consent in respect of this bill as it falls within the legislative competence of the Senate. I therefore move the motion. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Daniel Johnson to speak to and move Amendment 8205.1.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Indeed, I move the amendment in my name. I think before I say anything further, I think what is important to set out our issues with the Australian-New Zealand trade deal notwithstanding, trade is undoubtedly a good thing. And I think regardless of the circumstances that we find ourselves, we should be encouraging trade and looking for opportunities to do so, especially with places in the world such as Australia-New Zealand, where we have a lot of shared interest and a common history. But we do need to remember that the Australia-New Zealand deal was a deeply flawed trade deal, one which, in the absence of an oven-ready deal, was something rather snatched and grabbed at by UK government, desperately seeking to see upsides to the flawed Brexit that it sought to deliver. And we have much sympathy with the arguments that the Scottish government sets out. It is important that there is a role for devolved administrations and indeed devolved parliaments in approving and indeed devising trade deals. And these are arguments made by Nick Thomas-Simmons and other of my colleagues in the House of Commons, and we sought to make a number of amendments to this as it went through that. Indeed, I would note that in many other jurisdictions, devolved administrations and legislatures do have formal roles in the approval of trade deals, such as in Belgium. And I think it's of particular concern the ability of the UK government to make amendments without consultation if there is a refresh of this free trade agreement, essentially giving UK ministers carte blanche. That notwithstanding, I think there is a concern with the motion brought forward by the government, because while we agree that there should be a consultation with people in Scotland, that I don't think it's any more acceptable for Scottish ministers to be making decisions behind closed doors that can have very significant bearing on farmers and food producers than it is for UK ministers. That if this is a matter of concern for the people of Scotland, then it is Parliament that ultimately should be consulted on these decisions. And it's not so difficult for this place to pass instruments or legislative consent motions. It's something that we can do relatively easily and briefly, but it gives us that level of oversight. But ultimately, I would say this, is that ultimately, while people may not want to know about the detail of something that is probably relatively obscure in terms of everyday life, but it is ultimately important. I think people in Scotland are growing weary and tired of two governments that are constantly seeking to make constitutional rancour and disagreement the fundamental basis of their politics, rather than getting on in terms of making progress. I think what we want to see is two governments working together in the collective good, because regardless of your views of the constitutional arrangements and the way those should be, ultimately, whoever is in administration in Edinburgh and whoever is in administration in London need to work together in the collective interests of the people who live in these islands. And that, quite frankly, is not what is happening right now. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Jamie Hulcrow-Johnston.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly draw members' attention to my register of interest as a partner in the farming business in Orkney and as a member of NFU Scotland. And I'm also a member of the Economy and Fair Work Committee, which considered the LCM, and can I take this opportunity to thank our committee's clerks for all their efforts in drafting our report. This debate is largely one of process that has been discussed, but I'd like to start with the bills themselves. These two free trade agreements are the first from-scratch deals that the UK has negotiated since we left the EU. They're historic and they reflect the deep bonds, social, familial and economic, between our three countries. They will strengthen our trade with Australia and with New Zealand. They will deepen our ability to access their markets. And they could pave the way for the UK joining the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership. The Australia deal will see tariffs removed on all UK exports and a real boost for Scottish products like the iconic whisky sector and for our fashion sector. The Animal Welfare Charter with a non-regression clause stops any rollback on welfare standards. And the deal will make it easier for people to operate in each other's economies. It will remove visas, allowing young people from Scotland to travel and to work in Australia for up to 3 years at a time. The New Zealand deal will also see tariffs dropped on all products as well as red tape slashed for the nearly 6,000 UK SMEs which export goods to the country, businesses which employ nearly 250,000 people across the UK. Scottish exporters will now have an advantage over international rivals in a market expected to grow by 30% by the end of this decade. The UK government estimates that the FTA with Australia could increase trade between the two countries by 53%, with an increase in GVA of almost 120 million. The UK-New Zealand deal could increase trade by 59%. Businesses across the UK and across Scotland will benefit. The bill itself implements the procurement chapters of the two deals into UK domestic law, ensuring that the UK is not in breach of its obligations as the agreements come into force. And while the UK government's intention is that in the future, a power in the procurement bill will allow procurement provisions in international agreements to be implemented, legislation is needed now in relation to these two agreements, because they must be implemented before the procurement bill is likely to come into force. As the Economy Committee's report on the LCM states, there was agreement from members on a number of issues around scrutiny of the bill and an acceptance of the need for both governments to engage constructively. However, my colleague Graeme Simpson and I could not agree with the committee's recommendation that powers either conferred solely on Scottish ministers or that UK ministers should be required to obtain consent from Scottish ministers. The UK government has made commitments to the devolved administrations to not normally legislate within devolved areas, and whether they have to, not to do so without consultation. However, it is important that with international relations a reserved matter, the UK government is able to legislate to meet international obligations. If consent was put into the statute, as I know some here would want, it could discourage more consensual intergovernmental working and risk disagreements being decided in more lengthy and expensive court action. And there is also the risk that consent may be withheld for political reasons, that the Scottish Government might seek to create arguments for purely political gain. I know that suggestion may come as a shock to many in this chamber. But during our membership of the European Union, the Scottish Government was content for many of the powers they now dispute to be held in Brussels. And presumably, given their position on EU membership, they'd be happy to have them invested in Brussels again. So is it a genuine concern that the Scottish Government have over these powers? Or is it less about the concerns about the bill and more about stoking constitutional grievance? Is it that as the sun sets on this First Minister's time in office, the last act of this administration will be to leave us with one hurrah, last hurrah of divisive grievance politics? Or is it just that they don't like trade deals, because the SNP has never supported a trade deal negotiated by either the UK or the EU? They didn't support the deal with Canada. They didn't support the deal with Japan. They didn't support the deal with Ukraine. They didn't support the deals with South Africa or with Singapore or with Korea. They even voted against the deal between the UK and the EU, content to see us leave the EU with a no-deal Brexit. Presiding Officer, these are important deals that the UK government has negotiated with the governments of Australia and of New Zealand. As I've outlined, they will benefit people and businesses across the UK and across Scotland. And they include important protections for key sectors and in areas like animal welfare. On these benches, we support these agreements, and we will do so by opposing the SNP's grandstanding attempts to block them today. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I think Jamie Howcroft-Johnson deserves an absolute medal for his contribution this afternoon to draw some great credit out of these two trade deals with New Zealand and Australia. The only real, tangible so-called benefit that we've seen from Brexit in 6.5 years. So I think he deserves an absolute credit for his contribution this afternoon. Because not even George Eustace has recognised the benefit of the trade agreement with Australia and New Zealand. In fact, he criticised it, even though he was the minister that was in part negotiating the deal. So I would have hoped Jamie Howcroft-Johnson could have perhaps acknowledged that this is a pathetic set of trade deals. Of course, we support free trade. Of course, it's benefit to Scottish producers, to UK producers, the opportunity for export across the world. But to hold this up as a great success, I don't think, is reality. And I think Jamie Howcroft-Johnson truly knows that himself. But we will support the motion this afternoon. Of course, there should be greater scrutiny from this Parliament. There should be an involvement of this Parliament. There should be a greater partnership between the Scottish and the UK governments on trade deals. And it is disappointing that we're here once again with the same old song. We support Labour's amendment. We think it's appropriate for the Parliament to have the power, not just for the ministers to have the power. In fact, that's something that the Scottish Government has criticised UK ministers for holding on to powers when they should be scrutinised by the Parliament. But it is depressing, utterly depressing, that once again we have two governments that seem to be incapable of agreeing between themselves on an important area, perhaps of process, but nevertheless important for people's livelihoods. We should be able to, for the wit of man, we should be able to get the two governments to work together, to work up an arrangement for the scrutiny by this Parliament and by this government of any international trade deals. As Daniel Johnson has highlighted, other countries managed to do this, so why can't we do that as well? And it's perhaps a fact that over the last 15 years, this government has taken every single, often cheap opportunity to attack whoever's in power at Westminster. Perhaps that's led to this day, that the relationship has broken so badly that both sides are incapable of agreeing, which is why we need reform of the United Kingdom and change of governments both north and south of the border. We do need to have free trade. We do need to have cooperation between the two governments. It's for the sake of the businesses that produce excellent quality products. They deserve to be able to export those across the world. But they deserve also to have politicians in this Parliament scrutinising those deals, to apply our expertise to these trade deals, to make sure that they are fit for purpose. And once again, however, we have two governments that have let us down and have been incapable of reaching an agreement. I hope one day that we will manage to get some cooperation. I suspect it may be some time.
Thank you. And I call on Ivan Key to wind up. Up to 4 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. What an interesting debate. I agree with Daniel Johnson. Of course, trade is a good thing. If you've read our export growth plan, a trading nation, will be very well aware that that's stated right up front and centre. It'll be well aware of the trade missions I undertake on behalf of Scottish businesses on a relentless basis, and I'm off on another one next week with Edinburgh Chamber of Commerce to Poland. He'll be aware, if he's paying attention, that as part of those trade missions I engage with the UK government and now the no longer DIT, the DBAT, and the UK ambassadors and UK trade commissioners, and we work together closely where it makes sense to support Scottish business. We'll also be aware when he talks about the benefit of trade, that the biggest harm to trade has been done, of course, by Brexit, a policy his government still supports, and for some bizarre reason has been unable to be able, his party supports, and has been unable to been unable to bring itself to recognise the faults of Brexit as it seeks to become the next UK government. The process, of course, a formal process exists in other subnational governments, something we have proposed to the UK government to right from the outset of Brexit in 2016 with policies we put forward, and have relentlessly attempted to engage with them on a more structured mechanism for that to happen, something they've refused to engage on. On the point of accountability, Scottish ministers, of course, are accountable to the Scottish Parliament. The process, as you know, is that the Scottish Government would take forward those proposals, but would bring them to a Parliament or through committee as appropriate. And Parliament, of course, would have its ability to be able to scrutinise what was happening with those decisions. The point, of course, is, despite what Willie Rennie says, it's not through our lack of trying that those trade deals aren't coming here to be scrutinised by the Parliament. It's because the UK Government has decided to do so. Despite the fact that Jamie Halkrow-Johnson powered through and didn't take any interventions, I shall, in the interest of open debate, take your intervention.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you very much for the Minister for taking an intervention. If he and his government are so positive towards trade, why have you voted against every single trade deal that's been put in front of you?
Yeah. Minister.
Because his member should be well aware, if he's paying attention, the Australian New Zealand deals are very bad for Scottish agribusiness. Absolutely. And if you look at the Brexit deal, the situation with Brexit, of course, is that we should be back with part of the European Union and having free trade as a consequence of that, something we're absolutely very much in favour of. And we will take each trade deal on its merits. Trade deals, as the member does know and should know, is a balance of offensive and defensive interests. And if we think that Scottish business is having more harm done to it by the UK government rushing headlong into random trade deals, then we will of course vote in Scottish interests, and that as a consequence of that. Willie Rennie makes the point, as does Daniel Johnson, we should engage with the UK government. I think I made it very, very clear that we have engaged with the UK government. In fact, had a very constructive conversation in other regards about working together to secure investment with Daniel Johnson's namesake, Lord Johnson, this afternoon on this very issue. But that doesn't take away from the fact that the UK government has dug its heels in on this point and is denying the devolution settlement being able to be played out through the powers that the Scottish Parliament and Scottish ministers have as a consequence of that. And I think Willie Rennie needed any more example of the Conservative Party's unwillingness to engage on this process. The fact that Jamie Halkrow-Johnson wouldn't take a single intervention from anybody in the chamber kind of talks to that. And just to reflect on the point that Jamie Halkrow-Johnson made, it's not about Brussels. When those powers were held, when we were in the European Union, those powers were not held in Brussels in the way that they are held at Westminster at the moment. EU procurement directives were implemented by Scottish ministers and not by the European Union. That is the difference. When we were part of the European Union, the powers were here, and now we're not in the European Union. The UK government has taken those powers back upon itself and is encroaching on devolved areas, including procurement. So, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we're not happy with this situation, but, of course, I think certainly everyone, I would hope, on ourselves and everyone on this side of the Chamber would agree that devolution has to be protected, and it's important that we do so where there is an attack from UK government, and this is one of these, unfortunately, increasing number of examples where that indeed is the case. So I move the motion. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Trade Australia and New Zealand Bill UK legislation, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business.